Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? Okay, so I sent an email message a little earlier about the time zones of the online homework. That was a lovely surprise for all of us. The due dates were in the wrong time zone, which caused panic, it seemed, among a few. So the due date for that homework that was due last night has been extended to Wednesday night, okay, to make up for your 11th hour attempt. The first two quizzes are due Saturday in the testing center. Okay, and the written homeworks will be posted tonight. In fact, there's one posted right now, but I haven't had enough time to send a message about it. Okay, so then, any question about any of that? Yes?
When will the written homework be
done? The instructions will be on the thing. And was that your question also?
Yeah.
Okay. Other questions? No, no, I have to make them, right? I got to come up with them. But I will post them all as I make them. Other questions? Yes?
For the two quizzes this weekend, is it regarding chapter 2 through 5, what we basically learned last week?
Right. So the quizzes for week N are that are due in week N are always over weeks N minus 1. Other questions? Okay, so now we have a brief. Is that a, okay? So now it's what, the 31st? It flips upside down every once in a while. Okay, so then last time we were talking about slope charts and slope and all of this. So now we're going to briefly talk about concavity. So what slope is, conceptually, is that lines, that is to say straight lines, they have slope. If you take any two different points on a straight line that's not up and down, then you can measure the rise, how far the point goes up, and the run, how far the points are side to side. And no matter what two different points you select for a non-vertical line, the ratio of rise over run is constant. It doesn't matter if they're very close, the points, or if they're very far away, that ratio is always constant. So lines are said to have slope. And lines can be sloping, they can be sloping up, or they can be sloping down. Okay, and numerically that means that they have positive slope or negative slope. So that's a degree 1 polynomial. What is the name for a degree 2 polynomial? Its shape.
Parabola.
Okay, and parabolas are not straight, right? They're bendy. Right? And they bend in a sense, they open up or they open down, right? So their bend is either sort of the one way up like this, up, or down, like this. Okay? So they either open up or down, just like lines slope up or down. And the bendiness of a parabola, the technical name for bendiness, is concavity. Okay, concavity. So the idea is this is how functions bend. So to sort of make sure you have an idea of what this looks like, conceptually, we'll make a little table. Okay, so then this one will be slope. And this one, concavity. That is to say that in each position, for example, in this position here, this is where we're going to have positive slope and negative concavity. Positive slope and negative concavity. So let's make a picture for each one of these. So this is where slope is negative and concavity is negative. So the fact that slope is negative means that we need to start higher than where we finish, so that the result will have negative slope. And we also want to have negative concavity. So negative concavity is a bend that looks like this. So that's negative concavity. Okay, so now slope negatively. So we start higher than we finish. And now we want to have positive concavity, which means it needs to bend in the other way. So instead of bending like this, bend like this. So negative slope, negative concavity, negative slope, positive concavity. So see if you can fill in the other two. Okay. So positive slope. So this one is positive slope with negative concavity. Okay, and this one is positive slope with positive concavity. Okay, now, you may not be entirely comfortable with the concavity bit. How is it supposed to bend? Okay, so this is how you remember it. So in the specific case of a quadratic, so recall that if you have a quadratic, f of x is a x squared plus bx plus c, and a is not zero. Why does A have to be not zero? Yeah, because if it was zero, it wouldn't be a quadratic. Right? It'd be a line. Okay, so you can break quadratics into two groups. So here's a representative from one group, the kind that opens down, and here's a representative from the other group, the kind that opens up. So the kind that opens down, the kind that opens up. So here's the quadratic, ax squared plus bx plus c. What must be true about a, b, and c? What do you know something about one of a, b, and c for this one? What's true here? A is negative. A is negative. And A is related to the concavity, is related to concavity. So concave down like a frown. Doesn't it even look like a frowny face? Yeah, it even looks like a frowny face. So these two are the ones where the concavity is negative. So it kind of helps if I put little googly eyes here. See, like, oh, it's a sad function, right? So sad. concave down, like a frown. Okay, so then what must be true about A here? This is where A is positive. It even looks like a smiley face, doesn't it? It's impossible to not see it now that I said smiley face. So, are positive people smiling or frowning, by the way? Smiling. Okay. You may think this whole tack that I'm taking is silly, but in the end, if it raises the percentage of you who can remember what's going on, then I have achieved my goal as a professional. Okay, so then here I put googly eyes here. Look, oh, that's a happy function, right? Happy one, happy one. Okay, good. So that's how you tell concavity, okay, visually. Okay, good. Any question about this? So I could give you a function and say, well, where, you know, I could say in this region, is it concave up or down? More or less the question comes up to asking, well, I'll put little googly eyes on it. If it's frowning, then it's down. If it's smiling, then it's up. So this is called concave down, like a frown, and this one concave up, like a cup, right? Because this one would hold water. Beautiful. Okay, so the first derivative measures slope, and the second derivative is what measures concavity. So I'll just make that remark. So first derivative measures slope. Second derivative measures concavity. So just like last week when we were making slope charts and sine charts, what are we about to do right now?
Concavity chart.
We're going to make a concavity chart. Okay, wouldn't want to branch out too much. Okay, so let's have an example. And the other thing I need to say, sorry, is a definition of a point of inflection. So let the second derivative of a function be defined on an open interval containing x equal to c. So we need that. And let x equal to c, let f be differentiable at x equal to c. So let f be differentiable at x is equal to c. If the second derivative changes sign at x equal to c. Then x equal to c is a point of inflection. Okay, so visually, an example of this is something like the following. So here's a function. So if you just look at this region right here that I'm showing, is that region concave down or up?
Down,
right? Because you can put little googly eyes on it right there, and it looks like a sad function, right? So it's concave down there. Okay. So then in the other region, in this region right here, is it concave down or up?
Up.
Right, because similarly you can put little googly eyes on it and it looks like a happy function right there. Okay. So that means that this function is concave down and then up. So can you see where it changes from down to up? Okay. So at that place, just eyeballing it, that's about right here. So this right here is a point of inflection. Now, for people who like physical explanations of this, I'd like for you to imagine that this is a road and you're traveling on it on a car, in a vehicle with a steering wheel. So you're traveling on this road in the same direction that I drew it. Okay, so imagine that you're right here. How will your steering wheel be situated on this part of the road? Will it be situated turning left or turning right? Turning right. On all of this part of the road, turning right. Okay, and how about on this part of the road?
Turning left.
Turning left. On all this part of the road. And at this one instant, how will your steering wheel be situated?
Straight ahead.
That's what a point of inflection is. If when you're imagining that you're driving on a road, it's a place where you're turning right, 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 straight, left, 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 left. It's where you are straight. The steering wheel is pointed straight for just that instant. That is a point of inflection. Okay? So now, another example that is not a point of inflection is something like this. So now, in this region right here, is it concave down or up?
Down,
right? Because you put little googly eyes above the function, and then it's a sad function right there. So it's concave down there. And then in this other region, it's a happy function there. It's concave up there. So it changes from down to up. From down to up. Okay, but is the place where it changes from down to up a point of inflection?
No.
No, it's not. Why not?
Because it's not straight. Because your steering wheel's not straight.
There's no place where the steering wheel's straight, if you like. But that's just a physical analogizing thing. So what about the definition is saying that this is not a point of inflection? So here, look at this. Let f be differentiable. Is f differentiable at the place where it changes?
No.
No, it's not.
Why not?
Because it's pointy there.
Oh, okay.
Right? There's no tangent line.
Oh, that makes sense.
No tangent. And therefore not differentiable. And therefore not a point of inflection. Okay, so then changing concavity is not enough for a point to be a point of inflection. You have to change concavity at a point where the function has a tangent. If the function doesn't have a tangent at that point, it cannot be a point of inflection. Okay, good. Any question about the definition? Okay, so now that we have that, now we can do that example I was trying to do. Okay, so for example, construct a concavity chart and find all points of inflection. For the following function. So the function is x to 4 minus 8x to 3.
8x to 3?
Yes. Plus 18x squared. So a concavity chart. Okay, so what's the first step? Nope. Domain. Yeah, you find the domain. So how about it? The natural domain of this function?
All reals.
All reals. Right, so I could have given you, because this is the first example, I gave you a polynomial, which is the nicest possible kind of function to give you. Right? So you never have to worry about dividing by zero or square roots of negative numbers or any of that with polynomials. Okay, so all reals. So now the second step is now we want to find where the second derivative is undefined or zero. Okay, so then now on the way to doing that, what do we need to do?
First derivative.
Okay. So the first derivative, what is the first derivative?
4x.
Good, 4x cubed, 24, right?
24x squared plus
36x. Okay. So now, the problem was stated with this one function, and you have differentiated to find a new function. So the very first thing you must do is check the domain of the new function. So how about the domain of the new function? Still all reals. Okay, so there's no change. Every time you introduce a new function, the very first thing is got to check the domain. Got to check it. Okay, are we interested in where the first derivative is zero?
No.
No. Why are we not interested in that?
Because we're finding concavity.
Yeah, because we're making a concavity chart. The place where the first derivative is zero, we have a name for those points. What are those called? Starts with S. Ends with stationary.
So stationary points.
Stationary, okay, so stationary points. Okay, they're so important that we have a name for them. So we're not looking for stationary points. Stationary points is when you're making a slope chart, right, that kind of thing. Okay, so then what's the next step?
Find the
second derivative. So the second derivative will be the derivative of this one, so that it... Oops. Very good. So 12x squared minus 48x plus 36. Okay, so then now, we just came up with a new function. So what's the very first thing you do?
Check
its domain. So how about the domain of this? All real, so there was no change. Okay, so that covers the case when the second derivative is undefined. So what is the last thing to check? Where the second derivative is zero. Okay, so before I check that, I'm going to simplify the second derivative. So I can see that in this expression for the second derivative that I could factor it a little bit. So there's a common factor of 12, so I'll factor it out. So 12 and then x squared minus 4x plus 3. And then, oh, it's a quadratic. I wonder if that quadratic factors. Does it?
Yes.
Yes, right. So then 12 multiplied by x minus 1 times x minus 3. Okay, so then now that we have this simplified representation of the second derivative, let's find where the second derivative is 0. So when is that the case?
X equals 3 and x equals 1.
Good. So x is 1 or x is 3. So I'd like to point out that there were four positions in this exercise where we were trying to collect things. So here's the first one. We wanted to see, well, were there any breaks in this domain? And then we said, oh, there's no breaks. So we collected nothing from there. Then we checked here and we said, well, are there any breaks in the first derivative? And then we said, no, there's no breaks, so we collected nothing. And then we computed the second derivative and we checked, oh, were there any breaks here for this one? No, there were none, so we didn't collect anything there. And then finally we checked where the second derivative was zero, and then we collected two fence posts. So does everybody see that there were four places where we could have collected something? And we ended up collecting these 2 points. Did you have a question? So there were no breaks in the domain, right? So then it didn't happen in this exercise, but I could arrange for an exercise where there's no breaks here, but for the first derivative is undefined at 1, say. Okay. So now we're going to make a chart. A concavity chart. And I'll move this over just a little bit. So we're going to plot 1 and 3. Up, yes. Let's see, right. So we're going to plot 1 and 3. So now we need to select points in each region. So how about 0 and 2 and 4? So what are we going to do with 0, 2, and 4? Plug it into the first derivative?
No, second derivative.
If we were plugging it into the first derivative, what would we be constructing?
A slope chart.
But that's not what we're constructing in this exercise, right? So what do we need to plug it into?
Second
derivative. If we were plugging it into the third derivative, what would we be constructing?
A jerk chart,
right? So that's the answer. Okay, so we're going to take these numbers and we're going to plug them into the second derivative. Okay, and check for SIGN. So 12 is always positive, so that'd be that'd be positive, and then I plug in 0, I get negative, and then negative. Okay, so any question about the sine pattern in the first region? Okay, then I'll plug in 2. 12 is always positive, and then positive, negative. And then I'll plug in 4. Again, 12 is always positive, and then positive, positive. Okay, so any question about the sine pattern in each region? Okay, so now in each region we need to consider the overall SIGN. So in the leftmost region, what is the overall SIGN?
Positive.
Positive. And because we're making concavity, we need to use the positive concavity symbol, which is a smiley face. It's really just this, right? That's the symbol for positive concavity, but I always put the eyes. You don't have to. You will still get full credit even if you don't put the eyes. Okay. So, in the next region.
Negative.
And in the last region.
Positive.
Okay, good. Any question about the concavity chart? Okay. So then. The last bit of the question was, now, how about the points of inflection? So are there any?
Yes.
Okay. Where?
1 and 3.
1 and 3. Good. Any question about this exercise? Okay, why is there a point of inflection at 1?
Because it's where it goes from concave up to concave down.
Right, you can see it goes from up to down. Okay, so this is if you like steering wheels, this is where you changed from turning left to turning right. And this one here is where you change from turning right to turning left. Okay. Good. So one thing to note is that we have a specific name when slope changes from positive to negative, right? From positive to negative. That's called a local maximum. And we have a name for when slope changes from negative to positive. That's a local minimum. So we have names for the different cases in slope, but we don't have names for the different cases in concavity, right? They're just all points of inflection. This one is up to down, that's a point of inflection. Down to up, that's a point of inflection. And they don't have special names. Okay, let's have another exercise like this one, a little bit like this one. So, same instructions as previous. However, please, this time, make the function f of x is 1 over x. So same instructions as previous.
I said
boo. Boo. I'm going to let you get a few minutes ahead, just a couple minutes ahead. But you should note that there's just a slight trickery going on. Okay. So what's the first step?
Domain.
So how about it?
All real numbers except zero.
Good. So anything but zero. So that means that in this, remember, just like the previous exercise, there's going to be four places to catch fence posts. What this means is that we caught one right here. Right? So let's, now we need to go through the other three places where we could potentially catch fence posts and see what we catch. Okay. So now we need to find where the derivative, second derivative, is undefined. Or the zero. So on the way to doing that, we'll need the first derivative. And even before I do the first derivative, I'm going to rewrite the original function as x to negative 1. So that's just another way to write 1 over x. But this way is more convenient for the purposes of computing derivative. Right? It's easier to handle the power rule. So what is the derivative of x to negative 1? Very good. Negative x to negative 2. So if you liked, you could write this as, say, negative 1 over x squared. Okay, so we've come up with a new function. What is the very first thing? To check its domain. So how about it?
No change.
There's no change. Which is to say that we already established that f cannot be evaluated at zero, and neither can its derivative, for that matter. Right, so there's no change. Okay, are we interested in where the derivative is zero? No. No, because those would be stationary points. We're not interested in stationary points because we're dealing with concavity. Okay. The second derivative. So between these two representations of the first derivative, which one is easier for the purposes of computing the second derivative?
First one.
Yeah, this one's easier to deal with. So what is the second derivative then?
2x.
Very good. 2 times x to the negative 3. And then, if you like, you could write this as 2 over x cubed. So what do we do now?
Check the domain.
Check the domain. So how about it? No change. Okay, and this is where I have to say the following, and I have to say a couple things. So first off, I'm going to need to give you a homework exercise where there actually is a change, right? Because otherwise you might not believe that this is really a thing, right? So I'm going to have to give you one where there's a change in this position and give you another exercise where there's a change in that position so that you can believe me that this is a thing, or I can catch you if you don't believe me it's a thing. Okay, second is that I think it's terrific if you're able to see that there's no change in your head. I think it's terrific if you're able to see that. But the greater can't is not a mind reader, right? So what the greater is instructed to do, the greater is instructed to see, is instructed to look and see if you're checking every time. So that is to say that the greater wants to see you write, I'm checking the domain. I observed that there was no change. I'm checking the domain. I observed that there was no change. So the grader wants to see that. Okay, now this is in direct conflict with our shared human instinct to be as economical in our behavior as possible. Right? Which is a nice way to say that we're lazy, right? Okay, that's just a human trait. There's nothing wrong with it. Humans are, we're trying to minimize the amount of effort that we expend. But what I'm telling you is that's in conflict with what you actually want to do. in this class? What are you trying to do? Not minimize your effort, but maximize your grade. Yeah, you're trying to maximize your grade. How do you maximize your grade? You show your work. You say, I'm looking for a change in the domain. There was no change. I'm looking for a change in the domain. There was no change. Okay, so does everybody get it? I fully get it that that's tedious and boring. That's what's being graded. Okay. Okay, so that's done. So the second derivative, the last thing we need to check is where is the second derivative? Zero. So we need to solve the equation. 2 divided by x cubed equal to 0. Well, when is that true? When x is 2, that's 8, so that would be 2 over 8. Never. Never, right? So this is a fraction. This is a fraction, 2 divided by x cubed. If this is to be 0, if that fraction needs to be 0, that means the numerator needs to be 0. Right? So that's equivalent to saying that we need 2 to be 0. Well, when is that true?
Never.
It's never true. Okay, so there's no solutions here. So what that means is in the four positions that we could have collected points, right? We collected 1 in that position, none in that position, none in that position, none in this position. So does everyone observe that altogether we collected 1 point? Okay. So now we make the chart.
Is 0 an inflection point to the sum?
Let's have a look. Let's have a look.
Okay.
So 0 is the only place that we're going to plot. So I need something to the left of 0. How about negative 1? And something to the right. How about 1? So now what are we going to evaluate?
Second
derivative, because this is a concavity chart. So we're going to evaluate this. Okay. So then 2, that's always positive, so that'd be positive divided by, okay, x cubed evaluated at negative 1 is
negative.
So positive over negative. And evaluating at 1, 2 is always positive, so that'd be positive divided by, okay, 1, x cubed evaluated at 1 is positive. Okay, any question coming up with the sign pattern? Okay, so then what is the overall SIGN in the left region? Negative. So then what kind of concavity? Concave
down
like a frown, right? And then the overall SIGN in the right region is positive. So positive people are smiling. So we made a concavity chart. Any question about the chart? Okay. So then now, to address your question, are there any points of inflection?
No.
So I've heard yes and no, and one of these is correct.
0 is not the domain.
Ah, right. So there are two requirements for a point to be a point of inflection. The one that students all seem to uniformly memorize is that the concavity needs to change. Does the concavity change? Yes. What is the other requirement? It's more than needs to be in the domain. That
oh,
definitely. It can be 0.
Oh, okay.
What needs to be true? What needs to be true for the steering wheel?
It
needs to be straight ahead. So that means that you have to have a tangent line there. Two things. You have to have a tangent and the concavity has to change. Does the concavity change?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Is there a tangent? No, because it's not even in the domain. So there are no points of inflection. Now, it's far more obvious if you actually look at a plot of this function. This function looks like this. And so I ask, right? Do you see that here it's concave down? Down like a frown, and then over here it's up like a cup, right? Where is the steering wheel straight?
Never.
Nowhere, right? There's not a tangent here at zero. So that's not a point of inflection. Good.
So we know that there's no point of inflection because it's not in the domain. There's not something else mystical going on here. Right.
Right. But
I mean, I see what you're saying about the tangent line, but I'm just wanting to make sure that I don't have to know. I just need to know it's not in the domain.
That's enough, but I can also give you an exercise where it's like this.
That's okay.
Where it is in the domain.
Oh, where it is in the domain?
Where it is in the domain.
And how do we know that it's not...
It's not differentiable there.
Okay. Is that going to be closed intersection?
I think I'm going to have to now. Since there was a question. Okay. So, two things. Got to have a tangent. Got to change concavity. Both of them. Having a tangent means the derivative exists there. Other questions? Okay. Oh, I'm going to silence the questions now. Yes?
Can you do an example where the domain changes?
Yes. Yes. So just to give a quick example, here's a function f of x is x to the 2/3 power. And remember from back in the day, your college algebra days, this means x squared cube root. So that's what it means. Okay, so then now, we're not making a sine chart or a concavity chart or anything. I'm just showing you a place where the derivative...
Where the domain changes.
Where the domain changes. So what is the domain of this function? What's the domain of this?
All numbers.
All reals, right? Because what you have to do is you take an x and then you square it. You square anything, the result is non-negative, right? You square something positive, that's positive. Square something negative, that's positive. You square zero, that's zero. And then you can always compute cube root. So the domain is all reals. So now let's compute the first derivative. Well, what is the derivative of f? So we'll differentiate this. So we'll use the power rule.
2/3 x to the -1/3.
Very good. 2/3 x to 2/3 minus 1, right? 2/3 minus 1 for the power rule. And then 2/3 minus 1 is -1/3. So this would be (2/3 x to -1/3). Or if you like, you could write this as 2/3 multiplied by 1 divided by the cube root of x. Because remember, fractional exponent 1/3 is the same as cube root, and with it being negative, that puts it in the denominator. So we just came up with a new function. So anytime you're doing a math exercise and you come up with a new function, what's the first thing you check? Domain. So how about the domain of this? Anything but zero. So do you observe that the original function is defined everywhere, but you compute the derivative of this function, and now this function is not defined at zero. That means that it has a non-smooth critical point at zero. Okay, so this is an example of where this occurs. So visually, this is somewhat obvious. If you look at a plot of this function looks like this. It's supposed to be symmetric. Okay, so I claim that it's obvious that the derivative doesn't exist at a point. Where does it obviously not exist?
Zero.
At zero, because it's pointy there, right? There's no tangent. Okay? Good. So you really can, when you compute a derivative, the domain really can change. And I could make it to where it doesn't, where the domain is all reals for the original function and all reals for the first derivative, and then the second derivative it changes, right? We could do that. That'd be fun. Not really. Okay. Well, it could happen though. Okay. Good. Any question about this?
So this is not concave?
This question is not about concavity.
Okay.
The question was just, I interpreted the question as, please produce a function such that when you differentiate it, the domain changes. But since you said concavity, what is the concavity of the function in this region?
Down.
Down. What's the concavity of the function in this region?
Down.
Down. Again, right? So it's a sad function right here. Sad function right here. This one is not a point of inflection. Yeah. Good. It'd be down and then down again. Okay. So, constructing concavity charts is pretty fun, I guess. What is this? That's not what I want. Another thing that we need is called the second derivative test. So now it is, let the derivative of f be defined, the second derivative, I mean, be defined on an open interval containing x equal to c. And let x equal to c be a stationary point of f. What does that mean to be a stationary point of f? So I agree it is a critical number. There's two varieties of critical number.
Smooth. No, I think it's smooth.
Some people call them smooth.
Oh, okay.
But we're calling them stationary. What is the analytic condition, the equation or whatever that must be satisfied for a stationary point?
Equal to zero,
where the derivative is zero, right? So the setup is that we've got a function, it has a stationary point at C, and the second derivative is defined all around the stationary point. Okay? Then there are the following possibilities. Here's one possibility. The second derivative could be negative at C. Another possibility is that the second derivative could be positive at C. So what kind of concavity occurs where when the second derivative is negative? What kind of concavity is that?
Concave down.
So what we're saying is that we're at a stationary point and the concavity is negative. The concavity is down. So that means that it must look like this locally. Which means that we're able to make a conclusion about C. What must be true about such a C? Must be a local maximum. Now, I haven't drawn it yet, but I'm about to. What about my drawing is saying that C is a stationary point?
The number one?
No. What does it mean, visually speaking? What does it mean for a point to be stationary? What's equal to zero?
C is equal to zero.
C could be anything. C could be a million.
The tangent,
what about it?
It's equal to zero. Oh, the tangent is...
The slope of the tangent is zero, right? It's horizontal. Right? So having a horizontal tangent, that's what it means to be stationary.
Yes.
The first derivative represents the slope of the tangent line. Right. So when you combine these two pieces of knowledge, a stationary point where the second derivative is negative, that is a relative maximum, a local maximum. Okay, so then similarly over here, suppose we have a stationary point at C, and it is known that the second derivative is positive. Well, what kind of concavity is positive?
Concave up.
So, blue here at C. So this is enough to tell us what's happening at C. What's happening at C? It's a local min. It's a local min. And then, to indicate the stationarity, or whatever, of this point, stationariness, I don't know. There's its horizontal tangent line. Okay, good. So, if you're at a stationary point with positive concavity, that's a local min. Okay, good. So, in all of the other cases, that is to say, in the case where the second derivative is zero or the second derivative is undefined at the point in question, there is no conclusion. So what that means is that if you're trying to use the second derivative test and you find that the second derivative is zero or undefined, that means that you can make no conclusion. That doesn't mean that there's not a min. It doesn't mean that there's not a max. It doesn't mean there is a min. It doesn't mean there is a max. It means that you can make no conclusion. You must take other avenues to try and make a conclusion. So as a practical matter,
as a practical matter, when you're in this case, you fall back to a slope chart. In practice, that's what that means.
Okay, so any question about the second derivative test, the definition of it? Okay, so then let's use it.
So for example, find and classify all local extrema using the second derivative test. Okay, and the function is four x cubed plus seven x squared minus ten x plus eight. Okay, now, to be clear, this stuff that I'm underlining in red, so we did an exercise just like this last week. Except I didn't say using the second derivative test, right? I said using a slope chart. So how do you tell when you're supposed to use the second derivative test? When it tells you, right? That's how you tell. Okay. How do you tell when you're supposed to use a slope chart?
It'll tell you,
right? If it doesn't say, then it's a free-for-all. You can do whatever you want. Right? So then if you do this enough to develop preferences about it, then do whatever you like when it is unspecified. Okay. So what's the very first step?
Domain.
So how about it?
All reals.
Okay, so find and classify all relative extrema using the second derivative test. That means that, remember what the second derivative test does is it takes a stationary point and then checks the SIGN of the second derivative. So what we need to do is find the stationary points now. Okay. That means we need the derivative. So that'd be what? 12 x squared plus 14 x minus 10. Okay, we just came up with a new function. Check its domain. Still all reals. So the stationary points are when what? Yeah, when this is zero. So we need to solve the derivative equal to zero. But before we do that, I'm going to attempt to simplify this a little bit. So I can see that 2 is common. So if I factor out a 2, then that would read 6 x squared plus 7 x minus 5. Okay, then we need to factor this, right? It'd be nice to factor it. We need to know when this is 0. If we could factor it, that'd be nice. Otherwise, we could use like the quadratic formula or something. Okay, so then how about it? What do you think? How does it factor?
Why what?
So there's a variety of ways to do this. We could use the quadratic formula, but it looks to me like it's going to sort of just fall out nicely. So I'm just going to just hope that it's going to factor like this. Okay. So I'm going to hope it factors like this. I need to find factors of 5, so I'll put a 1 here and a 5 here. And then I need to find factors of 6x squared. Okay, so how about 2x here and 3x here, right? So then the product of those two is 6x squared. Okay, now this is minus 5, so one of these needs to be positive and one of them negative. So I'll try positive and negative. How do I check and see if I guessed right? By foil it back out. Okay. So if I do that, then that would be what? That'd be 6x squared and then minus 10x and then plus 3x and then minus 5. Notice that my guess was designed so that, well, yes, to be wrong the first time. Okay, yes, I agree. But also designed so that the first and the last term are correct. You observe that the first and the last term are correct. So the only question is did we get the right number in the middle term?
Yeah.
So we need plus 7x. What did we get?
Minus
7x. Oh, we didn't get it right the first time. Okay, so we're going to have to guess again, which is good teaching strategy. Okay, so then what was wrong with the guess?
Signs.
The signs were wrong. Very good. So 1 here and 5 here. So this, yes, should be minus and this plus. And then we can check that again real quick. So this would be what? That would be 6x squared and then plus 10x and then minus 3x and then minus 5. And then, oh, we got it. Incredible. So then the factorization is 2. And then multiplied by 2x minus 1 multiplied by 3x plus 5. Okay, any question about how we factored it? Okay, I have a question. Why did we factor it? Yeah, because now this tells us easily about the zeros, right? So,
I guess why did you factor the first derivative?
Because we're trying to find the stationary points. Stationary points are where the first derivative is zero. So when you have an expression that is factored, that makes it particularly easy to find where it is zero. Because this expression is the product of three factors, it must be, when this expression is zero, it must be true that one of these is zero, right? So that's true means that either 2 is 0 or 2x minus 1 is 0 or 3x plus 5 is 0. One of those must be 0. So of course 2 is never 0, so that's not part of the solution. So for this one, this would be x is half. I'm sorry? The reason why we're looking for where f prime is 0 is because we are looking for stationary points. That's why. We want to know, remember, stationary point is we're looking for horizontal tangents, places where the derivative is 0. So x is half or x is negative 5/3. Okay, so we found two stationary points. Now, we started the question so long ago that I forgot what we were doing. So what are we doing? Right, we're trying to find and classify all of the local extrema. Well, we found two stationary points. So what are we supposed to do with these stationary points now? Not a chart. Yeah, now we're going to evaluate the second derivative. Because remember, imagine in your mind's eye what a local
minimum looks like. What kind of concavity occurs at a local minimum?
Concave up.
What would we expect? What kind of concavity would we expect at a local minimum? So what SIGN?
Positive,
right? And at a local maximum, we would expect negative concavity. So what we're going to do now is we're going to compute the second derivative and evaluate it at these stationary points. Okay?
So this is where this is the classification step. So we need the second derivative now. Now, here's three different expressions for the first derivative. 1, and then 2, 3. Which one do you want to use to compute the second derivative?
The first one.
The first one, right? Because this one is good for solving equations, but it's not very good for computing derivatives, right? Because we'd need to use the product rule. But this one is just great for computing derivatives, right? So that'd be what, 24 plus 14, good. Okay, so now I'll just copy this down here. We're going to classify each one. So we'll do x as half. So we're going to plug x as half into the second derivative. So second derivative evaluated at half. That'd be 12 plus 14. And I don't know what that is, but it doesn't matter. Because it's positive, right? Some kind of number I've never heard of. That was a joke, right? Okay, so then it's positive. And so then it has positive concavity. So what is the conclusion about x is half? Yeah, this is a local minimum. Okay. Any question about classifying x as half? Okay, so now we'll classify x as negative 5/3. So the second derivative evaluated at negative 5/3, well, that'd be 24 multiplied by negative 5/3 plus 14. 24 over 3 is 8, multiplied by 5 is negative 40 plus 14. Okay. Okay, it likes that for some reason. Okay.
It does it
frequently. It just, and then it got stuck
for
that time?
Like a second at all.
I don't know what the thing's doing. I mean, anyhow, just let me know if it happens again. Okay, so here's a number. Here's a number. I don't know what this number is. But all that matters is what?
Negative.
That it's negative. Okay, so negative people are smiling or frowning?
Frowning.
So this is concave downing. Okay, so then what kind of thing is occurring here?
Local.
A local maximum. Good. Any question about this?
So, when the exercise explicitly says find the local extrema using a slope chart or using the second derivative test, that's what you got to do. But if it doesn't say, then use whichever of those two methods you prefer. Sometimes one method is easier than the other for a particular setup. And whatever situation you're in, determining which one is easier kind of really just comes with experience. You do enough of them and you say, oh yeah, it'd be easier for me to do the second derivative test, or easier to make a slope chart. Or maybe, I know I'm going to need a slope chart later, so I'm just going to go ahead and do it now. You know, that kind of thing. Did you have a question?
Yeah. So the x is equal to 1/2. That's a cut point? Or stationary points is cut point?
Maybe. I've never called it a cut point, but...
Critical point.
A critical point, yeah. So yeah. That's pretty common terminology. Okay. Yeah, I try not to use the phrase cut point, because depending on, it's a little ambiguous, because when you're making a sine chart, you can refer to those as cut points. Mm-hmm. And then when you're making a slope chart, you can call those cut points. Mm-hmm. And when you're making a concavity chart, you can call those cut points. Mm-hmm. So what's a cut point? You know, it's kind of confusing. So I like to use the given name for this stationary point. And besides that, on this exercise, we weren't even making a chart. Sounds like scope creep. Okay, any question about this before we go to the next thing? Because now we're going to go to something completely different. This is all this previous stuff is okay? Okay. So we find ourselves in section 7.1. Section 7.1 is antiderivatives. Okay, so just as a quick show of hands, Your previous calculus, just raise your hand if your previous calculus class had any antiderivatives at all. So, most of you. Okay, good. So this is a little bit of review too. Good. It's better. Okay, so then, definition. Antiderivative. Okay. Let big F and little f be functions. Okay, so then the following are equivalent. So this is an initialism, TFAE, that is exceedingly common in math courses. So TFAE, the following are equivalent. Okay, so first, the derivative of big F is little f. So here's a math statement. So you could write this math statement in any country where math is currently being studied, and everyone would understand the meaning of it. But if you were to render this sentence into English, then it would be rendered like this. The derivative of big F is little f. Okay, and this is where we have to go back to grammar school. Okay, and dissect this sentence into its parts. So I wrote the in red. What part of speech is the? Article. It's an article, right? And what are the articles in English? Sorry? Yes. There's the or the and a. Okay? So these are definite and indefinite respectively. Right? So the is definite. What is the meaning of definite article? It indicates something about the object. Right? So when I look out, when it's daytime and we go look out, right, what do you think? Does this sentence sound right? If I looked up into the sky and say, oh, look, a sun. No, right, the sun, right? The definite article represents uniqueness, okay? Whereas if I was to go outside and look up into the sky and say, look, the bird, that'd be pretty strange, right? Like, we're talking about, like, this is a singled out special bird? No, right? Look, a bird, right? Good. So, definite article, and then here's the subject, and then verb, and then object, right? Subject, verb, object. So now I'm going to rearrange this sentence and define a new word. So an antiderivative derivative of little f is big F. So several things happened all at once. I defined a new word, antiderivative. Okay, I switched subject and object. And in switching subject and object and coming up with this new word, I had to switch from definite to indefinite article. What does that tell you about little f's antiderivatives?
There could be more than one.
Yeah, there could be more than one. Okay? Could be more than one. Okay, and then now, here is a math sentence that could be written in any language, right? And here it is rendered in English. Here's the same sentence rendered in English defining a new word. And now I'm going to render this third sentence in math language. So then, this plus C represents the non-uniqueness of this procedure. So, in order to get you in the mood for this, we're going to play Jeopardy. You know, the game show where you're given the answer and you're supposed to respond with a question? Okay. So, normally, the way the exercises go is I give you something in here, and you're supposed to give me the right-hand side. Okay, that's the way it normally goes, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to give you the right-hand side. Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to tell me, what do I put in the blank to get it to work? X squared. Okay. So does everybody see that we could put X squared in there and that would work? Okay. Now here's a question. Is that the only thing that we could possibly put in there?
No.
All right. Good. So do you observe that, for example, we could write X squared here. Just take this X squared. And I could write, say, plus 12. All right, that'd work. And then, why does that work, by the way?
The derivative of 12 is 0.
Yeah, because the derivative of 12 is 0. Is that something special about 12 in particular, or?
No.
So what? It's a constant. Good. So, do you observe that, yes, we could put any constant in there, so x squared plus c, derivative of that is 2x. So any plus C could go in there. And so rearranging this sentence, right? Because these four sentences are all equivalent. Now I'm going to rewrite this sentence. I'm going to rewrite this sentence with antiderivatives instead of derivatives. So rewriting it with antiderivatives looks like this. Antiderivative of 2x dx is x squared plus c. So that plus c represents the non-uniqueness of this procedure. Okay. It is that reason that the plus c is a graded element of these exercises. Because if you don't write plus c, that's equivalent to saying that I don't understand that this is non-unique. Right? Okay, good. Any question about this? Okay. So now, corresponding to every derivative rule, for example, the product rule, the quotient rule, the chain rule, all of these rules, corresponding to every derivative rule, there is an antiderivative anti-rule. Okay, so now we're just going to go over the gamut of all the anti-rules. Okay, so... Sorry?
Okay.
Yeah, that's the first one we're going to do. So the power rule. Okay, so then the derivative form of this rule is that the derivative of x to n is what?
Nx n minus 1.
Very good. N multiplied by x to the n minus 1. So the way that this rule is constructed is that, and to give an example, the derivative of x cubed is what?
3x
squared. So the way the rule works is you take this exponent, you move it to the front, and you subtract 1, and that's the way it works, right? Okay, so then now for the antiderivative rule, we're going to have to do all of the individual steps are going to have to be the opposite. So instead of multiply, we're going to divide. And instead of subtract 1, we're going to
add
1. So all of the individual steps need to be their opposites. And furthermore, we need to do all of the steps in the reverse order. Okay, so this one, for this rule, you first multiply and then subtract. So for antiderivative rule, you're going to have to first add and then divide. So you're going to have to do not just the individual steps in reverse, but all the steps themselves must be in reverse. Which is to say that the antiderivative of x to n dx is. So we're going to add 1, so that would be x to n plus 1. And now we're going to divide by n plus 1. And then plus c. Okay, and to give a specific example, antiderivative of x to 5 dx, well, what would that be? Very good. X to 6 divided by 6 plus c. Good. Any question about the statement of the power rule? Okay, so let's go through a few of them. Okay, how about antiderivative of x to 4 dx, antiderivative of 1 divided by x to 5 dx, antiderivative of square root of x, dx,
an antiderivative of x squared times x cubed dx.
Can you explain the dx, please?
For the time being, I'm just going to say that it is part of the notation. So you can think of it like this x, whatever this x is, it has to agree with this one, just like this x has to agree with that x. So at this point, I'm just going to chicken out and say it's just notation. But in fact, it's actually quite meaningful, depending on what area of mathematics you're in. It's either going to be a differential or a measure or something like this. Okay, so the first one, pretty straightforward. How do you do it? Okay, good. X to 5 over 5, and then plus a constant. Good. Always start out with an easy one. Builds confidence. Okay, how about the second one?
X to -4 over -4. That's a log, right?
Very good. So it's not log.
Ln.
It's not ln either. Okay, so I'm going to make an error. So, okay, I'll make a number of errors. Okay, so here's attempt one. Is it going to be log of x to 5, something like this, plus c?
No.
So, no, this isn't it for two reasons. First off, it's just not. And second, we have, in this class, we haven't talked about log yet, so I don't even know what you're talking about, right? Right. Good. Good. I will do that, but now I'm going to have a second attempt that doesn't work. Okay. So I'm going to say, okay, well, maybe it's 1 divided by x to 6 over 6, like that, plus c. Is that right?
No.
Why not? I mean, isn't that the antiderivative of x to 5?
No.
Right?
No.
So...
So,
yeah, somehow what student has done is they just said, I imagine, like, okay, I'll just use the 1 and the 1, and then the antiderivative of x to 5 is that. It doesn't work that way, but nevertheless, there's a percentage of students who submit this answer, like, every time. Okay, so... Okay, good. So not this one either. Okay. As several of you have said, rightly so, yes, you need to write this as antiderivative of x to negative 5 dx. And now, once you've done that, you can use the power rule. Okay? So this would be good. X to negative 4 divided by negative 4 plus a constant. Okay? Yeah, you could write it in some other way that's more pleasing to you. I don't care.
That's fine.
Okay, how about this one? Right, you need to write this as antiderivative of x to 1/2. And now that you've written it with exponent half, you can proceed. So half plus 1 is what?
3/2. Right. So that would be x to 3/2 divided by 3/2 plus a constant.
And you don't want us to do that.
You can if you want.
So we can do 2x to the 3/2 over 3.
If that's better for you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Nicer.
Yeah, so I mean, if you like that, that's fine. Okay, so then how about this one?
X to the 5.
So I'm going to make it.
You have to do to each part.
Okay, I'm going to do that. So x to 3 over 3 multiplied by x to 4 over 4. Is that right?
Yeah, to x to 4.
No, that's not right. So what is my hypothesis about what student has done? So first off, let me cross that out, right? So no, that's not right. My hypothesis about what student has done is student said, okay, well, I'll use the power rule on that, and I'll use the power rule on that. Everybody gets a power rule, right? Okay, so then, now, this is antiderivative, which is the inverse procedure of derivative. So imagine that you're computing the derivative of a product. Isn't there some kind of rule that goes with that? The product rule, that's right. So wouldn't it be weird, and does it work like that? The derivative of a product, you just compute the derivative of the individual factors? No, that's not the way the derivative rule the product rule works. So that would be really weird if the antiderivative worked that way, wouldn't it? It doesn't work that way. But there is such a thing as the antiderivative product rule. But we're not going to do it for another several weeks. Okay, so yes. Someone said the right thing to do. What was it? First, right? First, let's simplify what's inside. So simplify what's in here. So how do you simplify that? Right, x to 5 dx. And then, now, okay, we can use the product rule, or the power rule, I mean. So x to 6 over 6 plus c. Right, and the general rule, the general heuristic, probably your previous calculus instructor said this. When you're doing a calculus problem, you should always think, well, did I take algebra first, or did I take calculus first? Algebra. And so, generally speaking, it is usually a good idea to perform all algebraic simplifications prior to doing any calculus. So you'd look at this expression. Can I algebraically simplify it? Yes, then I should before I do any calculus. Good. Any question about these examples? Okay, how about one more? How about x squared plus x to 10 divided by x to 5? Oh, no, we can't do this one yet. So I'm gonna finish writing it, and then I'm just going to write a question mark. Right? So we can't do it yet, according to what I've written. So now we need to have some more rules so we can proceed. Not yet, but not yet. So, but before we proceed, I think, yes, now it's a good time for a joke. Is it that time? Okay, so what's the answer here? So x cubed over 3 is the answer that I heard, but that's what I heard first. So here it comes. So here's a joke, and you should know that in math culture, right? There's jokes. The mathematician is usually someone who gives an answer that's correct, but it's totally a useless answer, or it's correct but nonsense, or correct but not useful, and that kind of thing. And then the physicists, they're usually reckoned to think of themselves as incredibly smart and superior, but end up doing dumb things all the time. So here we go. Here's the joke. Two physicists walk into a bar. And the first physicist says to the second one, says, isn't it great to be a physicist? Because we're so much smarter than everyone else. It's so great. I feel sorry for the rest of those people out there. Right? And the second one says, you know, I'm not real sure that that's as true as you think. And the first one says, it is true. We're just so much smarter. And then he walks off to the restroom. And the second one walks up to the bartender and says, okay, bartender, now listen. When my friend comes back, I'm going to ask you a question. You're not going to have any idea what I'm talking about. But it'll be a question, and what I want you to do is I want you to respond with x cubed over 3. Can you do that for me? Can you respond with x cubed over 3? And the bartender says, yeah, okay. Yeah, I'll do that. And so the friend comes back and says, okay, look. I'm gonna, I'm gonna, Let's test something, okay? And the second physicist calls over the bartender and says, okay, bartender, what is the antiderivative of x squared dx? And the bartender says, x cubed over 3. And he says, see, I told you. And then the bartender interrupts and says, plus c, you jerk. And that's funny because the bartender knew better than the physicist, right? Physicists. I have nothing against physicists. You just got to understand that's the math culture of the jokes. Okay. Good. I totally lost my spot. Oh yeah. Okay. So this is the sum and difference, and constant multiple rules. Okay, so first is that remember that for derivatives, you can pull out a constant multiple. So for example, what is the derivative of 10x? Just 10, right? Because that constant multiple just hangs out. So similarly for antiderivative, the antiderivative of constant times f of x is constant multiplied by antiderivative. Okay, so constants can come outside just like derivatives. So for by way of example, antiderivative of 5x squared dx, well, that would be 5 multiplied by the antiderivative of x squared dx. That 5 just comes out. And then what's the antiderivative of x squared dx? Plus c, you jerk, right? So it's no, every time I write plus c, I hear, from telling that joke so many times, I hear you jerk, right? Plus c, and then I hear in my head, you jerk.
Right?
Oh, thank you. I got so carried away. Plus. Good. What?
It was upside
down. Oh, it was upside down. Okay. Okay, is it right now?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so then similarly, the derivative distributes across sum, antiderivative distributes across sum. So f of x plus g of x, antiderivative, is antiderivative of f of x plus antiderivative of g of x. Okay, and by way of example, how about the antiderivative of 2 plus x to 7? Well, what's the antiderivative of 2? Not 0. The derivative of 2 is 0.
2x,
right? It's equivalent to asking whose derivative is 2? Whose derivative is 2?
2x.
Good. And then what is the antiderivative of x to 7?
X to 8.
Very good. Okay, so then now I wrote a question. I wrote an exercise on the previous page, and then I said, oh, wait, I forgot because I did it in the wrong order. So here it is. It was
antiderivative, and then x squared plus x to 10, and then divided by x to 5 dx.
Okay. So, how do we proceed?
Separate them?
X squared over x5.
Okay, good. So, and I agree, I'm going to do that, but first I'm going to make an error. Okay. So I'm going to say, well, isn't this x to 3 over 3 plus x to 11 over 11 divided by x to 6 over 6? Right? And then plus c, I remember the plus c.
So what, is this right?
No,
right? So then what did student do? Yeah, just power rule, just everything. You get a power rule, you get a power rule. Right. No, that's not the way it works. So student sort of, in a sense, anti-differentiated numerator and also denominator. So that when you're computing derivative of a quotient, do you just compute the derivative of the numerator and then divide it by the derivative of the denominator? No, right? You have to use the quotient rule. So it would be really weird if antiderivative worked this way. It doesn't. So yes, the correct procedure is to first, right? What course did you take first? Algebra, right? So then let's divide. So this is, x. Thank you. X squared over, well, you gotta let me know, because normally this camera is actually pointed in a slightly different direction, but I can't point it in the direction I want, because when I do that, it turns upside down. I don't know what's going on with that. And so as a result, I can usually hold the page about 4 inches further down. So sometimes I forget. Okay, so then I did it, and now what?
Now you use algebra.
Yeah, okay, now one more algebraic step. So x to negative 3 plus x to 5 dx. So now does everyone see? Oh, okay, yeah, power rule. Now we do the power rule. Okay. So that would be x to negative 2 divide by negative 2. Plus x to 6, divide by 6.
Plus c.
Plus c. Good.
Any question about this? Okay. So how about, let's mix it up just a little bit.
Okay, what if I tell you that the derivative of f is 8x plus 1, and the derivative evaluated at, not the derivative, and the original function evaluated at 3 is equal to, say, 27. Why not? Okay, so then the instruction is to find the original function.
So I didn't give you the original function. I gave you the derivative of the function in question, and I told you what the function in question evaluates to at a specific point. Okay, so then I want you to tell me what the original function was. So this is like, you know, it's like 20 questions, right? I've given you enough to figure out the answer. Okay, so the way this goes is, here is sort of fundamental thing trying to get across today, that the function is the antiderivative of its derivative. It's saying that if you differentiate first and then anti-differentiate, that should, in a sense, be the same as having done nothing. Right? So we're going to anti-differentiate what? What do I need to plug in here? Okay, good. 8x plus 1. Okay, and then here's something that we can anti-differentiate. So what is the antiderivative of 8x? 4x squared. And then the antiderivative of 1 is x. And then now plus c. So at the present position, have we uniquely recovered f? No, we haven't. Because we don't know what c is supposed to be. If only we had a little bit more information. Oh, but we do have a little bit more information. Right? What have we not used? We haven't used this. We know that when we plug in 3, we're supposed to get 27. Okay? So now we will use this bit. To determine C. Okay. So 27 is what we're supposed to get when we plug in 3. So that'd be what? 4 times 9. Plus 3 plus C. So 4 times 9 is 36, plus another 3 is 39. So 27 is 39 plus C. Negative 12, right? So negative 12 is C. And so as a result, we've now completely recovered little f. Little f is 4x squared plus x minus 12. We did it, right? So then now, this kind of exercise is called, If you're a science major or an engineering major, this exercise is called an initial value problem. Because what it's telling you is this in a sense is like at every point it's telling you how to turn. It's telling you how to move. And this is telling you where you need to start. So you can imagine that maybe you have a friend and your friend says, "Oh, come to the party. Come to the party. It's such a great party." And then you say, "Okay, well, just give me directions." And then the friend proceeds to give you very precise directions, right? Okay, proceed north 3 meters. And then you know, gives you a list, 100 steps long, of how to get there. Okay, and then you very carefully follow this list. And then when you're done following the list of instructions, you're out in the middle of a field. And you call your friend back and say, "Hey, what's going on here? I followed your directions very carefully." And then the friend says, "Well, did you start at Walmart?" And then you say, "Well, no, you didn't provide that." So now I need to go back to Walmart, right? This is start at Walmart. That's what this part is, right? If you leave that out, right, it doesn't matter how precise the instructions are if you don't say where you're supposed to start. So this is called an initial value problem, because you start here and then you do all of that, and when you do all of that, this is what you have. Okay, if you're a math major, then this is called a Cauchy problem, because it's named after a person named Cauchy. Okay, good. So now, to make a
remark. So the power rule. Could someone just quote the power rule for me? Very good. X to n plus 1.
N plus 1.
Divide by n plus 1. And then plus c. Right? Okay, so then now this works for almost every possible value of n, but it can't work for all values of n. What value of n does it not work for?
E.
It works for 1.
Zero.
It works for 0. It doesn't work for negative 1, right? When n is negative 1, it doesn't work. Because if n was negative 1, that would be division by 0, right? So this works for any n at all except negative 1. So we've got a problem when n is negative 1, which is to say that this antiderivative of x to negative 1 dx is unknown to us currently. And x to negative 1 usually is written like this, antiderivative is usually written as 1 over x. So the antiderivative of 1 over x is not handled by the power rule. But don't you know something whose derivative is 1 over x? Log, right? So that's the subject of the next proposition. So the first one is easy. We know from differential calculus that the derivative with respect to x of e to x is what? E to x. So as a result, the antiderivative of e to x is e to x plus a constant. So that one's pretty easy. Now, from differential calculus, we also know that the derivative of log of x is what? 1 over x. However, furthermore, besides that, in addition to, we also know that the derivative of log of absolute value of x is what? Just 1 over x. Just 1 over x. The reason why that's the case, by the way, in case... Well, so how about let's compute with the chain rule. What's the derivative of the log of kx? Well, according to the chain rule, right, that'd be u prime over u, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that'd be kx prime divided by kx. But what's the derivative of kx with respect to x?
K.
So this would be k divided by kx. And so that k has to be non-zero in order for this to be defined. So this is just 1 over x. So the derivative of log of 3x is 1 over x. The derivative of log of million x is 1 over x. The derivative of log of negative x, negative 1 times x, is also 1 over x. And as a result, that means that the log of the absolute value of x, its derivative is also 1 over x. So the consequence of this is that the antiderivative of 1 over x dx is log of absolute value of x plus a constant. So this is inherited from this one. Many students seem to omit the absolute values. It's
common occurrence. Yes?
Before we go, can you remind us what's coming up with this theme? Sorry, someone,
So, presently, the things that are due, there are some online homeworks due Wednesday night, and I don't know what's further than that for online homeworks, but there's a schedule that has all of the due dates on it. And I sent a link to the schedule in email to the mailing list. And there's also quizzes due on Saturday.
Will there be another quiz for this week?
Yes, tomorrow I will put two new ones.
Two new quizzes, okay.
At the testing.
Well, just because, the Saturday needs to be the day, so I need to figure out what I need to do.
Right, so there's going to be on the order of two quizzes every week.
Okay.
And
do every Saturday?
Right, but you don't have to do them on Saturday.
Well, yeah.
You could. I mean, the window is...
Well, I just don't know if the window changed.
It's going to be Saturday. Yeah, because that seems to be the best.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Yeah, the written homework questions, I'll just post them whenever I think of them. Right. On the lecture. On the lecture, yeah. Not currently. Okay. No, so I won't. But you can come to my office and you can ask me to check it. I won't necessarily tell you what the answer is, but I'll be glad to consider it and give you a hint.
Why does it post grading of the homework and get a maximum study for the quiz or test?
Of course, yes. All of your quizzes and all of the written things that you give to me will be returned. Other questions? Okay, so we've got just a little bit more to go, and then we're done, right? 10 minutes. I lost my place. Oh, yeah, here we go. Okay, so how about antiderivative of 4x cubed plus 10 x divided by x to 4 dx. Okay, what do you think? Algebra first, right? Algebra first. So this would be 4x cubed over x to 4 plus 10x over x to 4.
In that problem, you could separate it into two derivatives.
Right. Okay, so then taking the first term now and simplifying it, that'd be 4 over x. And then taking the second term, that'd be what? 10 over x cubed?
And that would be 4 over x because it would be 4x minus 4.
Right. 3 of the x's in the numerator cancel. So this is a good representation for that term, but that's not a very good representation for that term, so I'm going to rewrite that one. So let it be 4 over x, and then plus 10 x to negative 3 dx. That's a little nicer. Okay, so then now,
Are we ready? So what's the antiderivative of the first term?
4 log.
Very good. 4 log absolute x. Okay, then plus, what's the antiderivative of the next term? So plus 10x to negative 2 divide by negative 2. And then plus c. And then usually the instructions say simplify, and I'll leave that to you. If the instructions don't say simplify, then please don't. Okay. Good. Any question about this one?
So.
Yes? No. So, let's be clear. There's a difference between 4 log x and log of 4x. Right? The position of the 4 is quite significant. I don't know if I've answered your question. Yeah. Okay, so one last exercise. So how about antiderivative of x to x to x, like that, plus x squared plus 3 minus x to x to x. Don't blurt anything out. So I'm going to give you a hint, and the hint is this term right here, you have no hope of computing its antiderivative. None whatsoever. Oh, she sees it. So if I've given you an exercise, and presumably the questions that I give you have answers, and I say that you have no hope of computing the antiderivative of this term, what? Yeah, it must mean that you... Yeah. Do you observe that these two terms cancel? Okay. But I would like to point out to all of you who didn't see that, that you need to rewire that rule in your head. Okay. Perform algebraic simplifications first. Okay, so I'm just showing you this here and now, where there's no points to be won or lost. Okay. So this is the antiderivative of x squared plus 3, right? Which is less of a big deal than the previous one. So then this would be x cubed over 3 plus 3x plus c. Okay, so now we have just enough time for a joke. All right, so what is the antiderivative of 1 over cabin d cabin? Log cabin, but that's only half credit to log cabin. Because it's a houseboat. When you add the sea to a log cabin. All right. Have a good night.
Yeah.